Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining me for this episode of Healthytarian Living. Today, I am happy to host special guest, Dr. John McDougall. Dr. McDougall, hello and welcome.
Well, thank you. It's good to be here. And I already know just from our short conversation, we're going to be talking to an audience that's open-minded and willing to look at look at the facts, those that are obvious and those that are hidden in the scientific journals.
Absolutely. And so before we go any further, I will share a little bit more about you for anyone who may be new to your work. Dr. McDougall is a physician and nutrition expert with over 30 years of experience with respect to the effects of nutrition on disease and better health through vegetarian cuisine. He is the founder and director of the nationally renowned McDougall Program and the McDougall Health and Medical Center. Dr. McDougall is also the author of several books, including his latest, The Starch Solution, Eat the Foods You Love, Regain Your Health, and Lose the Weight for Good. And so on that note, let's begin by getting your overall, a summary of what is your approach to optimal nutrition for the human body?
Good. And thanks for the introduction. There are a couple of things I would like to emphasize to the listeners so that they understand where I'm coming from. I'm a regular medical doctor. I'm a board-certified internist. I think I'm well-respected by my colleagues. I'm not a holistic doctor. I'm not an alternative medicine doctor. I'm licensed in 5 states. I'm fully certified by the Board of Internal Medicine. So you shouldn't expect anything anything unestablished from me. As an internist, as a medical doctor, I treat people suffering from food poisoning. Oh, boy. I'm already into a controversial term. The people around you, if you just stop for a minute and look, the people around you, your friends, your relatives, your coworkers, they're suffering from food poisoning. And you may not have heard it in those terms. You may have thought of it as just obesity or diabetes or constipation or indigestion or arthritis or cancer. But these are diseases of food poisoning. Just like if you took arsenic or lead, you ate these things, you'd get sick. You'd lose your fingernails and your hair, and your bones would be diseased, and it would be from a poisoning. And what's happened in the United States over the last, particularly 70 years, and is now happening in China and India, is people by the billions. Yeah, I guess billions is the right word. Yeah. People by the billions are being poisoned, and they're being poisoned by animal foods. And what I mean by that is chicken and fish and beef and pork and cheese and milk and vegetable oils. And as a result of this food poisoning, just like if you took arsenic or lead or you ate some microbe that was making you sick, as a result, they're developing diseases. Pretty much everybody in the world knows that obesity and type 2 diabetes is due to the food. Most people haven't become specific enough about what the foods are that are making people sick. And the next question on your listeners' minds is, okay, you just told me that everything I eat is killing me. Well, that's true. And so your question now has to be, well, what do I eat then if you just labeled everything that I now eat as making me fat and sick? Well, that's the important part of the discussion that we need to go into, is that what you need to eat is you need to eat the food that 9.5 billion of the 10 billion people who've walked planet Earth have eaten. What most people that have lived on planet Earth for the last, well, you could go back as far as 2.5 million years, but certainly for the past 100,000 years. The food that most people have eaten is starch. Okay, now let me just stop for a minute so that we're all on board here. The Mayans and the Aztecs, I mean, these were successful people that had civilizations that flourished for 1,300 years. The Mayans and the Aztecs were known as the people of the corn. Their diet was corn. Some of you have been to South America. The Incas were petite people that ate potatoes. And so they went to battle, and because potatoes were so bulky to carry, they brought quinoa to fight their battles. In Asia, for at least 10,000 years, the primary source of calories has been rice. Up until 1980, 90% of the calories of people in China and Japan and Vietnam and Cambodia came from rice. So what we need to be eating, once you figure out that you're suffering from food poisoning, which is really easy to stop. Now, food poisoning is animal foods. I'm going to make it easy for you. It's any animal food, even salmon, folks, and any free oil. Well, when I'm talking about free oil, I'm talking about the stuff you get in a bottle, like olive oil and corn oil and so on. Those are the major food poisons. You know, we can talk about salt and sugar later. They are minor food poisons. But those are the major food poisons. So when I take away all your foods, you say, what do I eat? Well, what you eat is you eat oatmeal for breakfast and hash browns, pancakes, and whole wheat bread. And then for lunch, you go on and you have, or dinner, let's just talk about lunch or dinner together. You could have bean burritos and spaghetti noodles with marinara sauce. You could have mushu vegetables and rice. You could have sweet potatoes. So this is what the kind of rethinking that I'd like to encourage in the listeners is: your diseases, your fatness, your overfatness are not a mystery. They're due to food poisoning. Just like if you lost your fingernails and your hair and you were consuming lead, that's the problem. You stop the lead and your fingernails and hair grow back. You have to identify the food poison and then believe it because it's true and all the evidence is there. It's not controversial. And then you have to decide you're going to stop it. Just like an alcoholic stops a half a bottle of whiskey a day and a tobacco smoker stops two packs of cigarettes a day. You just say, I'm not going to do it anymore. And you stop those foods. And with tobacco, you breathe clean air. And with alcohol, you drink water. And with food poisoning, you switch to the traditional diet that 9.5 billion of the 10 billion people that have walked this earth have consumed. That's all you do. And then you get well. Then you lose the weight. Your greasy skin goes away. Your bowels start working. The indigestion stops. Your blood pressure drops. Your cholesterol drops. This is unquestionably scientifically documented without any controversy at all in terms of science. Yes. But I know you're confused.
You have a beautiful free resource colored ebook that is available also on your site at drmcdougall.com. And I will have the link also at the bottom of this video for anybody who's interested in seeing and really learning the core of everything you've just said in a nice, also visual fashion. So we'll have that link. So before we go at looking at some of the specific foods and answering further questions that people may be wondering about or confused about, let's talk about the starches, you know, at their core essence and how to really understand starches. Why are they good for us?
Well, it's because the human being just has a diet, just like my cat Einstein. Einstein's sitting on the next couch. I'd introduce him, but we don't have to. Einstein has a diet. He is a carnivore. He's got teeth and claws and so on. And Einstein is supposed to eat meat, and he does. Now, if I took a baked potato and I threw it down in front of Einstein, what would he do with it? Maybe bat it around like a ball of yarn. He wouldn't eat it because it's not his food. If I forced Einstein to eat baked potatoes for the next 4 or 5 days, he would be sick and dying. That's his food. Well, what needs to be answered by every scientist, every doctor, every mother, every father, every responsible person needs to have an answer as to what is the diet of the human being. The human being is designed as a starch eater. We're a very special animal. It distinguishes us from chimpanzees and apes, gorillas, you know. Chimpanzees and gorillas, let's just talk about gorillas. They're vegetable eaters. They're vegan. Chimpanzees are 97% vegan. They live on perishable vegetables and fruits. They don't live on starch. It's a very tiny part of their diet. And these great apes, they're confined to the equator because that's the only place on the planet where you have fruits and perishable vegetables all year long. So the great ape is confined to the equatorial zones. What happened in human evolution, primate evolution, is the primate evolved to have the ability to tap into a whole other source of food. And this took place with changes in the teeth, the gut, changes in our genetic code. We started producing genes in greater abundance that digest amylase, which is starch. At some time in primate evolution, the primate developed the ability to tap into a new food source. As a result, primates were confined to the equatorial zone. Once we were able to tap into starch, we were able to move out of the equator and migrate across the planet. So that when fall and winter came, if you were, say, north or south of the equator, as an ape, or a chimpanzee, or a great ape, you'd starve to death because your fruits and vegetables were gone. But the human primate developed the ability to tap into starch with the amylase-producing genes. So you move north and south of the equator. Winter comes. What you do is you dig in the ground and you dig up underground storage organs. These are called potatoes and sweet potatoes and bulbs and corms. So, and then what you do is you figure out as a primate, as a human primate, you figure out that you can take above ground storage organs. Remember I said underground storage organs are your roots. You take above ground storage organs, which are seeds. They're carbohydrate seeds called grains and legumes. So you grow grains and legumes, or you find them in the field. You find them in the summer and the fall, and you put them in a dry place, and you and your family get to live all year long in a latitude like is New York City or Detroit, Michigan or Ottawa, Canada. If you were a great ape without the ability to digest amylopectin and amylose with your amylase genes, you would starve to death. But because you're a special primate with a unique ability to tap into these storage organs, we as humans were able to migrate across the entire planet, dominate the entire planet, survive under all kinds of circumstances. So the human primate is unique in its ability to digest starch, which we always have and still do. We are starch eaters. Now, the problem that confuses people is we are also survivors. The human being can live on two packs of cigarettes a day, a half a bottle of whiskey a day, and hot dogs and butter, and they do. So people say, okay, I have friends that just eat bacon, butter, and brie, as taught by i.e. Atkins and the other low-carbers, and they live, and they lose weight. And you go, how remarkable. But the human being's a survivor. What everybody should be asking is, what allows the human being to look, feel, and perform at its optimal best? And that is starch. Okay, so all of history, all your religious teachings, the Bible, the Quran, whatever teaches you you're a starch eater. If you look at performance in the past, like for example, gladiators of 1800 years ago, they were known as the barley men. The reason they were known as the barley men is because they lived on barley and beans. They were vegans almost exclusively, as opposed to the people who lived in the other communities of the Roman Empire, which were a lot of rich people. They could eat pigs and cows and so on. Okay, so the gladiators were barley eaters, were known as the barley men. And why were they known as the barley men? Because if you went in the Colosseum and you weren't at your best, you didn't have endurance and strength, you didn't get to come back because somebody put a trident in your head and killed you. So that's why they were barley eaters. Today, your winning athletes, your bicyclists, your endurance athletes, since 1968, all of the Olympic winners for endurance races, the top four places, have been dominated by Kenyans and Ethiopians. These are starch eaters, these runners. You might look at your Runner's World magazine or your different exercise websites. I mean, they may teach you a lot of nonsense, but what they will clearly tell you is the Ethiopians and the Kenyans win all the events. There was just a race last month in Honolulu, one of the big triathlons. Guess who won? The Kenyans. So anyway, the human diet, from everything that all your listeners can see, they know this, has always been a starch-based diet. When people gave up starch, as they did in Egypt 3,500 years ago, the pharaohs, the priests, the queens, the kings, they got so rich that they could live on cows and sheep and pigs and pheasants and the pharaohs, if you look back at the archaeologic findings, you'll find that they had horrible atherosclerosis. They had obesity, gallbladder disease, just like Americans. What has happened is over time, because of harnessing of fuel in the last 100 years, fossil fuel, because of technology, the Industrial Revolution, we've been able to elevate a few people to billions of people. So now we have the whole United States, the whole Canada, and over the last 30 years, India and China, who all live like kings and queens. So they eat at Burger King and Dairy Queen, and they eat Imperial margarine. And they, if you just look around, I mean, I don't care what you used to believe, look around and your sister looks like a queen. And your coworker looks like a king and he has gout. It's just stupid simple. We have replaced the human diet, which is a starch-based diet with fruits and vegetables. And I'm not saying these were vegans. You know, people ate anything they could find, bugs and termites and dead, you know, dead animals and everything. But their diet, because they were gatherers, and I'm going to make a comment here because I know you'll like it. Their diet was primarily starch-based. You could store starches through the winter. You could survive. It was a survival card for human beings. And just a few people got rich, and whether they were King Henry VIII or whatever culture you look in, these rich people who abandoned starch and ate animal foods, they ended up fat and sick with atherosclerosis. Now, today, what's happened is we've, because of our economy, we've been able to elevate even the poorest people to the diet of kings and queens.
Yeah.
That's why you're sick. What I was going to say is I just wanted to add one thing, because I think you'll like this. The listeners have been taught that we're hunter-gatherers.
Mm.
Okay. And we were. We were hunter-gatherers. But in that hunter-gatherer equation, there's something called sexism. Gender bias, which is what has changed the story over all of history and even today. Who were the gatherers? Grandma and grandpa, the children, and the women. Who were the hunters? Okay, so the men, they left the village. They patted the women on the head, as men always do. And they said, we're going to go kill an animal. And so a bunch of men took off with their spears, and they went out and they killed an animal. And hopefully they were able to bring it back before it rotted. So what you hear is you hear the glory of men. Do you think sexism is present today or was present in the past? That's why you hear we're hunter-gatherers with an emphasis on hunting. It's because that's what men did. And the lowly work, which provided virtually all the calories, except for some exceptions like the Inuit Eskimos and other few exceptions. All the calories were provided by women and grandma and grandpa and the kids. What glory is there to that? So all the things we're talking about are based in common human behaviors. Sexism, greed, gluttony. Is it just nothing different? It's just that we can afford to do that in mass today. And that's why China, the country of China, now has population where half the people are pre-diabetic. 12% are actually full-blown diabetic. But that's today in 2015. In 1980, fewer than 1% of the population was diabetic, and there was no obesity, and they lived on rice. Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, maybe some of you, I mean, most people in the world are now in their 20s and 30s. I'm near 70. But your grandmother and your father and your mother lived in times that I did. Most people can remember when things were different, and it was because of the starch.
And it's, you know, it's very important, I think, to emphasize here a very key point that, again, is for listeners to take away, that there's a difference between what is optimal for the human body versus what we can survive on or use opportunistically, because this is what I know a lot of people keep coming back to. Well, look at us, we seem to be doing fine, right? But we really aren't. And this is also the key takeaway message, is that the fact that we've made disease and, you know, weight issues almost like the norm doesn't mean that it's natural. And so this is what is very important to keep coming back to. So you've mentioned certain foods like potatoes, which of course have, you know, been vilified so much. And I always try to explain to people, you know, this is a wholesome, natural food. And you've also mentioned weight issues, etc., and how they are not related to the starches or the carbohydrates in the sense that people think, but more to the animal products and the isolated oils and fats and such. Can you talk a little bit about the glycemic index? Because this is, I know, a point of controversy for some people and something else that needs to be understood from its broader perspective rather than, you know, that pigeonholed way that often paints a very poor picture of optimal nutrition.
Yeah, I'll talk to you in detail about glycemic index because I do know a lot about it. But I want to make sure that I just want to emphasize in the next 10 seconds that the problem is food poisoning from animal foods and oils. The solution is you just need to get back on the human diet.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, the science has studied foods for a long time. And I've been studying their studies for 40 years. And I've also, the major research has been done since 1920. One of the interesting bits of research that was done in 1982 was done by David Jenkins, who's from the University of Toronto. He's a friend of mine. He's a vegan. And what he and his group did, David Jenkins, is they looked at food and found one of the characteristics of food was, which is when you eat it, your blood sugar goes up. Okay? And what they did is they decided to make a standard of 1 or 100%. And that standard rise in blood sugar was based upon how high the blood sugar rises if you eat sugar, or white bread, depending on which standard you want to use. So they called that 100%. So you mm-hmm. eat a certain amount of white sugar or white bread, and you measure the blood sugar, and it goes up, and we'll call that number 100%. Okay. And then what they did is they fed other foods to people and compared the rise in blood sugar to the standard of table sugar or white bread. Okay, and so if you feed people potatoes, the blood sugar rises to a level of 118%. White sugar is 100%, potatoes go to 118%. Okay, if you eat a Snickers bar, the blood sugar rises to 67%. So obviously Snickers bars are better than potatoes. To the uneducated person, that's what I mean, this has been published in the press. All right, so what are we talking about here? Well, when you eat, the reason you eat is to get energy. Your blood sugar is supposed to go up. Athletes, winning athletes, purposefully choose high glycemic index foods so they can replenish their sugar and glycogen. That's why you eat. Now, animal foods, let's just say chicken, fish, beef, pork, cheese, they're low on the glycemic index, whereas potatoes, rice, corn, etc., they have sugar in them, which has to be digested, and it causes the blood sugar to go up, which is supposed to do. Now, where people get confused is this. There's a disease called diabetes. And in that disease, the blood sugar is up. So because the blood sugar is up in diabetes, people have assumed falsely, absolutely incorrectly, that any food that causes the blood sugar to go up is bad because of diabetes. The truth is that where people eat high glycemic index foods, like China, we just talked about China, mm-hmm. or South America with potatoes, or corn in Mexico, they have no diabetes. I just told you the figures. Before 1980, fewer than 1% of the population had diabetes in China. Now half the people are pre-diabetic and 12% are fully diabetic. What do? They gave up the high glycemic index rice and substituted with low glycemic index meat. Back in 1940, a guy named Hemsworth published his final paper in the British Medical Journal. He started his research in 1920, and what they showed in the 1920s was that when you fed healthy people, they actually used, in some cases, medical students, and when you fed them sugar, I'm talking about white sugar, what happened is the blood sugar went up a little bit and they came down and the blood sugars were of normal patterns. They took these same medical students and same patients, et cetera, the literature is absolutely without controversy, and they fed them a diet high in fat. And in the experiment I'm thinking about by Sweeney in 1927, every one of the medical students became diabetic.
So what we've known since the 1920s, and it's without any controversy at all, is that sugar, and I'm talking about white sugar, not that I'm trying to say white sugar is good for you. It rots your teeth, raises triglycerides, it's empty calories. It's not health food. But if you feed people with or without diabetes white sugar, everything about their diabetes becomes better. If you want to take a healthy person, like a billion people in China, and you feed them oil, fat, animal fat, and vegetable oil, they'll become diabetic. It's been known since the 1920s. There's no controversy here except for the ignorance that dietitians, scientists, lay people continue to have. They refuse to look at the science. Or if they do, they distort the science. And we can get into that in a whole other topic. But anyway, glycemic index is a way, is one quality of food. David Jenkins, who I've known for, well, I've known him since the 1970s, is the one that brought this to the public's attention. It is one quality of food. There are other qualities of food, like how much fiber it has, how much vitamins, minerals, how much cholesterol, how much environmental poison from DDT and PCB, how many prions from mad cow, how many leukemia viruses, how much Ebola, how much porcine diarrhea viruses in it. I mean, there are all kinds of qualities of food. Glycemic index is just one of them. But people have focused on that, writing entire books, which have misled people into what glycemic index really means. More than you want to know, I know.
And picking, therefore, choices that are not actually optimal for their health, but ones that are destructive, but being under the idea that, you know, these are actually good because the glycemic index seems to say so. So thank you for explaining that. And another area that, you know, seems to steer people away from wholesome starches is the discussions or ideas that have become pronounced now about nutritive inhibitors or even other digestive issues that are being brought to the limelight today, like the whole gluten, you know, controversy, et cetera. Can you talk a little about this and help people understand this side?
Well, I can talk a little bit about it. I could talk in great detail if we had time. But I think as people listen to these various theories about why we're sick, phytic acid. I mean, phytic acid is a basic part of plants. Let me just get a little off topic here. God, or nature, or the divine being, created plants correctly. There wasn't a mistake in putting potatoes together. They just happened to put enough protein, enough vitamin C. Potatoes are the anti-scurvy vegetable. Enough fat, enough everything in a potato, so it was designed perfectly. Phytic acid was not put in vegetables by mistake. Okay, let's just kind of drop that for a minute, because we could discuss it for an hour, and I could probably go back and review the science more carefully and give you an even more intelligent discussion. But let's go on to this whole gluten thing, because this is a big deal. 40% of the products that are sold in stores are labeled gluten-free. Gluten-free cakes, cookies, 40% of the customers in the store are looking for gluten-free foods. This is a tragedy. Not only for the fat, sick people who are looking for solutions in gluten-free cakes and cookies, which they don't find, actually they get fatter, but also for the people who really do have celiac disease. There's something out there, it's a rare condition, it's called celiac disease. I see it maybe once or twice a year. Probably one in 250 people, but just to be generous, even the most adamant person about the dangers of gluten will tell you that celiac disease occurs in fewer than one in 100 people. Those people who have celiac disease, they get very, very sick when they eat wheat, barley, and rye. Why it hurts those people is they go into a restaurant and they order pea soup. And the waiter brings out the pea soup with croutons mixed in it. And the person with celiac disease eats it, gets sick, very sick. And the person who has celiac disease says to the waiter, "Why did you bring me the pea soup with wheat croutons in it?" He says, "Because it doesn't make any difference. The last 40 people were in here who told me that they couldn't eat gluten. I gave them the same soup. Nothing happened to them." You see? So this misinformation not only hurts people who are trying to get good health,
but it hurts people who really need to stay away from wheat, barley, and rye, say 1 in 250 people. That's probably true. It's a bad thing. And I'll tell you what else it does. What really concerns me is that it is a distraction away from what we need to focus on.
Yeah.
You see, what's happening is we've got these issues, and I hate to introduce it right now, and I know I'm going to make some enemies, but one of them is called GMOs, and another one's called gluten. Not that these aren't real problems. They are. But I have to correct myself. Finally, somebody sent me the first case of GMO disease that has ever occurred in a human being. I was sent last week, because I always say, I've never seen a case of GMO disease. And before the first case of GMO disease appears, Earth will burn in hell. And that really makes me mad. So we have a problem. We have these Frankenstein foods created by Monsanto and so on, which sound evil, and probably are. But from a practical point of view, no one suffers from GMO disease. But 80%, 90%, 95% of the people in the Western world are dying from food poisoning from eating animals and oil. And they're worried about GMO, whether kids are sitting there constipated and arthritic with headaches and fat. You know, 17% of the kids are obese, and they're looking for the answer in GMO or gluten. The answer is right in front of you. You're poisoning your kids with oils and animal foods. When they want to, they say, Mommy, Mommy, I can't chew this meat. Mommy, I can't drink that milk. It makes me sick. Mommy, could I have some pasta? All right. So anyway, let's just leave GMO alone, because I've already made half your listeners. just realize you've never seen a case of GMO disease, but everybody that you're going to see today is suffering from food poisoning from eating animals and oil. As far as gluten goes, fine. You can't tolerate wheat, barley, and rye. Don't eat it. Eat potatoes and sweet potatoes and corn and rice. You still need to be on a starch-based diet. So if you believe you have gluten sensitivity, I'm not going to correct you. There's no reason to. Just eat a starch-based diet without wheat, barley, and rye. No problem.
Let's talk a little bit also about the cancer connection as well as heart disease. If you can start maybe also to share some of the information and research, how it is so, you know, healing and preventative against, for example, cancers.
Okay, well, let's talk about cancer, because that was the topic of my newsletter for February 2015, which I just finished like 7-10 days ago. I published the first study on the dietary treatment of breast cancer in 1982. Anyway, if you look at my February 2015 newsletter, I published the first study on the dietary treatment of breast cancer in a medical journal. Since then, there have been multiple studies done on treating people with cancer with a healthy diet. Now, what happened February 13th of 2015, let me say that date again. February 13th, 2015, is the American Cancer Society came out with an official policy that people with cancer should eat the kind of diet that I've been recommending for 30 years. Not exactly, but more whole grains, less meat, less oil. It's the official American Cancer Society recommendation of February 13th, 2015. And it is that's what's happened since, when I was a young man, a young doctor, to now is the evidence has accumulated to the point where it's irresponsible for doctors and medical societies and governments to not act on this information to help people. It has gotten to the point now where not only does the American Cancer Society recommend that you should eat a healthy diet to prevent breast cancer, colon cancer, and prostate cancer, which has been common knowledge and relatively well accepted for the last 40 years. Their official policy now is that if you have cancer of the breast, colon, prostate, melanoma, etc., you should eat a healthy diet, because not only will you live healthier, but you will live longer. It should be the fundamental therapy prescribed by every doctor, every oncologist, every dietitian. According to the American Cancer Society, it should be the fundamental therapy provided to all cancer patients, not only because it works and costs nothing, it has no side effects, it's because the other treatments, which I'm well studied in, the treatments for breast cancer, prostate cancer, and colon cancer will go down in history as one of the most serious abuses, harms, dangers, mistreatments of human beings that's ever occurred in all of medical history. To amputate a woman's breast for breast cancer is mutilation, which has been proven since the 1920s, certainly by 1951, to not prolong survival by a single day. Yet, women that are your friends in your community will be mutilated today by their doctors. Maybe not so much with mastectomy, which was over 95% of the treatments when I was a young doctor. Maybe it's only 30% now. But they will be biopsied and radiated and poisoned by drugs that have been proven without doubt to not work and to make people sick and to destroy their fortunes. So when you have that kind of treatment, radiation, chemotherapy, and surgery, which are conclusively proven to do far more harm than good, and I will argue with your best oncologist about that. Not only do you have complete failure, so no hope of getting better with standard treatments, no hope, and certainty of being harmed and mutilated and causing your family's fortune to disappear. When somebody comes along, like the American Cancer Society did February 13th, 2015, and say that fundamental therapy for cancer patients should be the diet you and I are talking about, progress has been made.
Yes. And that is definitely positive to see and to hear about. And so the other major chronic lifestyle disease that we have prevalent today, aside from the diabetes and the cancer, is of course heart disease. Can you just share a few things perhaps in terms of how the starch solution is a solution also for heart disease?
Heart disease only occurs, and we're talking about coronary artery disease, atherosclerosis and ruptured plaques. This disease only occurs in people who eat the diet of kings and queens, without exception. You can go back, you can go on the internet right now, you can look up the pharaohs of 3,500 years ago, you can look up about the priests and priestesses who, by the way, used to steal the offerings that were given to the gods. Sometimes even before the blessings were over, they would steal the meat and take it home to their families. Anyway, you can see their mummified remains. Who got to be a mummy? The kings and queens. I mean, they're the ones that were mummified. They ate the rich diet. Some of the queens were obese. They had gallbladder disease, et cetera. Even their children suffered from dietary diseases. Anyway, the only place you can find atherosclerosis, whether you look at the Inuit Eskimos from 500 years ago, or you look at the pharaohs from 3,500 years ago, or you look in your community hospital down the street, the only place you can find atherosclerosis is in populations that eat a diet containing food poisons, which are animal foods and oils. This disease does not exist any place in history or geography. It does not exist in people who eat a starch-based diet. And plus, it's reversible. Then that has been shown, you know, Blankenhorn showed it in the 70s at UCLA. Nathan Pritikin showed it in the 80s. Walter Kempner showed it at Duke University in the 1950s. Dean Ornish is showing it today. It is, you know, regardless of what your denying friends say, this is a disease caused by your fork and spoon, which can be reversed. And the scientific evidence is absolutely consistent. The problem is that the education that goes to our children and our doctors and our dietitians is graciously provided by the National Dairy Council, the cattle industry, and the scientists that they buy.
Yeah.
So you've got that problem of the money. Where's the money? Follow the money trail. Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen. It doesn't change when you become a doctor, a dietitian, or a hospital. You've got one other problem I'd like to just throw out to you that you don't want to miss. And that is that people love to hear good news about their bad habits. So when they come out and they say wine prevents heart disease, how many people do you think believe that? Or they do a front page article in the San Francisco Chronicle that says chocolate has antioxidants that'll make you healthy. How many people buy that newspaper?
Yeah.
And I ask myself, why is it that that the low carbers, which means the Atkins people and the wheat belly and the grain brain and all the other
paleo.
Yeah, whatever. Why do they get attention? Well, meat, dairy, and egg industry, people love to hear good news about their bad habits. But the other fault I have to lay with the press, the media is so desperate today, they will publish anything in their headlines that'll get the customer to buy their newspaper or their Time magazine, June 2014. Eat butter. The experts were all wrong. Or the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times. I asked myself, how do otherwise intelligent people whose job it is to research the science and the literature, how do they get away with publishing articles that hurt children? They hurt children.
Yeah.
They hurt men and women who want to be productive. How do they get away with publishing this? They're lazy and they just want to sell magazines. They're acting like human beings. That's their problem.
And this is, you know, such an important point, because this is, again, how any, you know, business sort of mentality works. If bring on that sensationalism or bring on something that, you know, will make people be attracted to it, right? And so, as you pointed out a few times as well, is that it is so wonderful to hear that our bad habits are actually what? They might be good for us, right?
Yeah.
And that excuse, we you know, find comfort in just hearing that, yeah, it's all good. Just keep doing what you're doing. But again, just because disease and weight issues are so prevalent today does not mean that they are the natural way to live. And this is, again, what, you know, doctors like yourself are trying to help people understand, is that there can be an optimal way to live with, you know, in optimal health, with excellent vitality and longevity.
Last month, we were on the front cover of Women's World magazine. It said something to the effect, eat potatoes and lose 200 pounds. I mean, I had nothing to do with the story. But every time you walk through a Safeway or a CVS pharmacy, you went to the cash register, there was this front page of Women's World was about our work. Why do you think they had that headline there? It's so that they did sell a lot of magazines. But the next week it was probably, I don't know what it was, but I know in the past they've had articles, don't eat bread, whatever. So they're just but I believe the media has more responsibility than that. I believe their responsibility will go far beyond just selling newspapers and magazines and TV news stories. They have a job, whether it be with food or national defense or, you know, the environment or whatever. The media has a responsibility to do the right thing, and they're not. And to this date, I have not seen a responsible reporter from Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, or any place take this issue seriously and out, isn't that what you say, out the liars, the people who are manipulating the evidence, cherry-picking the research, and hurting people, the damage they've done. And there should be a responsible person who will stand up, and somebody at power at Wall Street Journal or New York Times or Time magazine will say, wait a minute, you know, this isn't right.
Yeah.
But they haven't to date.
Yeah.
They will.
Yeah.
Believe they will.
Well, I'm definitely hopeful on that front as well. And so as we begin to close, I'd love to close on a line that is featured in your writing and something that I resonate with a lot myself, and that is the topic of moderation. We just, like, you know, give the people what they want to hear kind of has been portrayed in so many ways. We know that the line, everything in moderation, has also been used, abused, and, you know, manipulated in so many ways. And you share, moderation does not work for life-destroying habits. I love that.
Yeah.
Can you feature some last advice on that front?
Remember, I'm a doctor. I've been taking care of patients since 1968. So you can do the math. It's been a long time. And what I've observed, and I think every one of you, the people listening, can observe, is that people, there are some people who are moderate. My wife is moderate. I'm not moderate. But still, she's in better health today at almost 70 than I think she would have been if she hadn't met me. I tell her all the time how fortunate she was she met me, but, you know, I'm just joking. Anyway, there are some people like me who just can't do anything in moderation, and a lot of your listeners are the same way, and it shows. I mean, two-thirds, three-quarters of the people are fat. Half the people have heart disease. If you got to know them like I do as a doctor, they have indigestion all day long. Employers, there have been studies done where employers have studied what their employees are thinking about, and a third of the time they're working and being paid, they're thinking about their intestines. Anyway, my point is, we got to moderation, is that people are dying from very serious diseases like smoking and lung cancer and alcoholism and traffic accidents, and they're dying of very serious problems. Your kids are fat and sick because of food poisoning. Your husband, you may lose your husband from a heart attack because of food poisoning. Your wife may lose one of her breasts because of food poisoning. You're not getting out of life for you and your family because of food poisoning. And I wish, and it would work, by the way, it would work if you cut down. If I could smoke one cigarette a month, I would smoke, but I can't. I smoke two packs a day or I smoke none. If I could drink, oh man, we won't go into that. But I, you know, they're just people like me and the people listening who can't do a little bit. Because once you give yourself permission, then you just can't. And it's that way with food. So you have to decide, let's see, am I tired of feeling bad all day? Am I tired of the horrible acne? Am I tired of the arthritic pain? Am I tired of worrying about my husband dying of a heart attack or my wife getting breast cancer, uterine cancer? I mean, what am I willing to do to change? It costs me nothing. There are no side effects. What am I willing to do? Well, you can cut down if you want, but you can't. I wish you could, but you can't. All you can do is what I do, which is I do things in terms of green and red, right and wrong, is you have to identify what the problem is. So I figured out back October 20th, 1972, that I was killing myself with Marlboro cigarettes. Okay, so I tried cutting down, and I tried everything I could, but I couldn't. It took me almost 12 years to quit. Then I finally figured out the only way I'm going to do this is I have to identify the problem, which was the 40 Marlboro cigarettes a day. I have to stop doing that. So I did. Now, I'm telling you and your listeners that the reason you're fat and sick and not performing at your peak is because you have food poisoning. Now, the food poisons are animal foods. Make it real easy. Animal foods. That means swimming, walking, flying animal foods. And oil, that means corn oil, health food, olive oil. They're killing you and your family. And the way you fix the problem, like I fixed the dirty air problem, is I breathe clean air. The way you fix the food problem is you eat starch, rice, corn, potatoes, green and yellow vegetables, and then you get well. It always happens. It always works. Just like always a cigarette smoker decreases their coughing and an alcoholic stops falling down when they stop the booze, you will always get well. But what you must decide to do, you must first identify the problem and the solution. Then you must say to yourself, I'm not going to do that anymore. And as soon as you do, what happens in 24 hours, the greasy skin starts to get better. The bowels start to work. You throw away the antacids. We published, you can find it, it's in November of 2014, we published our most recent study on 1,615 people. Where we showed, this is work I did for 10 years. We've got other studies coming out from Oregon Health and Science University and multiple sclerosis, and we published them on arthritis and so on. What we found, let me just talk about the 1,615 people that we published on. I published on 500 15 years ago, and it's always the same, is in 1 week, I'm talking about 7 days, this is what happens. The average cholesterol drop is 23 points. That's better than you can do with statins. The average blood pressure drop, and people stop 90% of the time all their blood pressure pills. The average blood pressure drop is 8/4 millimeters of mercury, but people with really bad blood pressure, they drop, you know, 25/15 or whatever. But 80-90% of people get off all their blood pressure pills. 100% of people get off all their diabetic medication, but just as our general group, 80-90% of people got off all their blood sugar medicine. That means pills and insulin. Or type 2 or similar, not type 1, diabetics, and their blood sugars stayed the same. Their triglycerides stayed the same. And all of the subjective things you can't talk about is the constipation stopped, the indigestion stopped, the fatigue stopped, and that all happens in 7 days. So anybody whose attention we've caught, and you think that I'm exaggerating, just do what I say for 7 days, and you tell me that I'm not telling you the truth. What an investment.
For anybody who may be hearing this information for the first time, start with something like your book, The Starch Solution, because, you know, within a half an hour or an hour, we can only share so much. But get the broader perspective, get the deeper understanding, also follow the science, but most powerfully, try it for yourself, as you just said. I love that question that you posed, and this is something that also I like sharing with people, is what am I willing to do? What am I willing to do? You know, am I done with being sick and tired all the time, etc.? So thank you so much for sharing that.
It was a pleasure. It was you're a very good interviewer, and I'm sure your audience is an attentive audience seeking the truth. And hopefully, we've added to their journey in a positive way.
Hopefully, indeed. Thank you. And so, for anyone who may be interested in looking into more of Dr. McDougall's work, especially some of the writing, which, as you mentioned, you've got a regular newsletter that is full of lots of studies and the science and the information and practical tips and articles and recipes on your site as well. I recommend starting at drmcdougall.com. Are there any other areas that you'd like to share, such as your Twitter, Facebook, or any other events?
Well, we do have, I think we have 60. You can just guess based upon what I look like, is that that's not my generation, Facebook. But we have, fortunately, people who work for us who are very much into Facebook. And I understand I have like 65,000 friends, whatever that means. And so the Facebook is a good place. The other thing I really want to point out is that Mary and I, and you can learn our story, it's all on the website. Mary and I were given a great gift between 1973 and 1976. We were just very young people. I was your age. And we were given this great gift, which has resulted in good health for both of us and our family, and a very rewarding medical practice I've had for 44 years. And because we were given this great gift, you'll go to the website and you'll say, where's the gimmick? You know, where there's got to be a gimmick here. He's got to be selling something. And I get letters all the time after a week or two of exploration. They go, you know what? I couldn't find the gimmick. You give everything away free. And that's right. Everything is, you know, you can't go to Costa Rica or Hawaii with us free. You can't come to my 10-day program where I am the doctor for free. Or next, in fact, in 5 days, we've got this huge weekend with about 300 people that are coming, called an advanced study weekend. I mean, there's certain things we can't give away free, but you'll find 500-600 recipes. You'll find all the scientific information, all the meal plan, everything you need. I don't care if you're the poorest person listening here. We'll save you money. We'll cut your food bill. We'll stop your supplements. We'll stop your medications you're taking from your doctor. We'll stop your trips to the hospital. We'll get you back to work the best we can. It's all free. There are no gimmicks. It is 100% free.
Yeah, to really make it accessible for all people. And I really like that as well. And so thank you, Dr. McDougall, for being here with us today. It's really been a pleasure to share more of your work and information.
Thank you. It's a lot of fun.
You're very welcome.
I hope other people consider the conversation that tone too. Sometimes I can get a little bit enthused.
Well, thank you. Passion is usually a good sign. So thank you. And thank you to everyone who joined us today. And until next time.